Hello everyone. In the last lecture, we studied the difference between biodegradable waste and non-biodegradable waste. Children, how many of you at home helped your mom in the kitchen that by keeping two dustbins of biodegradable waste and non-biodegradable waste by labeling the dustbins? That means whatever vegetable peels, fruit peels are coming, whatever vegetable waste, left out food articles, that you have to keep in the biodegradable dustbin, and plastics, polythenes, glass bottles, all you have to keep in another dustbin. This way you can help your mom. In this chapter you can take knowledge and you can apply at home. Okay, now that was the last lecture. Now today teacher is going to teach ecosystem. Now what is ecosystem? So ecosystem is the structural and functional unit of biosphere is called ecosystem. Or you can define that all the interacting organisms, which are living organisms, together with the non-living components that constitute a system, that system is called ecosystem. Now ecosystem is classified into two types: natural ecosystem and artificial ecosystem. Natural ecosystem is not operated by human beings. It is a gift of nature. That is why it is called natural ecosystem. Now natural ecosystem again classified into terrestrial ecosystem and aquatic ecosystem. Or land ecosystem, that is called terrestrial ecosystem. Where, like for example, desert, grassland ecosystem, forest ecosystem, they all are land ecosystems. They are terrestrial ecosystem. Now next one is aquatic ecosystem, which is operated in water. That is why it is called aquatic ecosystem. This aquatic ecosystem, for example, pond ecosystem, lake ecosystem, marine ecosystem. So these all are natural ecosystem. But the ecosystem which is operated by human beings, which is maintained by human beings, that is artificial ecosystem. This artificial ecosystem, example, botanical garden, park, crop field. Next topic is components of ecosystem. Ecosystem consists of mainly two components, biotic components and abiotic components. As the name indicates that biotic components, bio means life, that is examples are all living components will come in biotic components. All living components, for example, plants and animals. These all plants and animals, we use the term, comes in biotic components. These plants and animals, in lower class we say plants and animals. Now in higher class, to these plants we say producers or autotrophs, because they prepare their own food. And animals, they are called heterotrophs, because they consume the food which is made by. So animals are called consumers. They are called consumers. Or another term is heterotrophs. Heterotrophs. So you understood, if I will say the term heterotrophs, that means all plants, and if I will say heterotrophs, that means all animals. So biotic components are living components, whereas abiotic components, they are all non-living components. They are non-living but very essential for our survival. So all abiotic components are non-living components. For example, solar energy. Solar energy is the ultimate source of energy which is trapped by plants. So it is very important, sunlight, there is solar energy or sunlight. Temperature, moderate temperature must be there for our survival. Atmosphere, atmospheric conditions, wind, water, soil, land, these all are the abiotic components which are very essential for the survival of biotic components. So biotic components and abiotic components together constitute ecosystem. Next topic is food chain. So what is food chain? Food chain is the linear network of organisms through which energy is transformed in the form of food by the process of one organism consuming the other. When one organism is eaten by another organism, the energy is transferred from one organism to another organism. Like for an example, grass is eaten by grasshopper, grasshopper eaten by frog, frog eaten by snake, and snake eaten by eagle. So one organism becomes the food of another organism. So in this way, the flow of energy which is showing, that is called food chain. That linear network is called food chain. Now, another topic is food web and how this food web is different from food chain. Food chain is a linear network of organisms where one organism becomes the food of another organism. This food web is a network of so many interconnected food chains. A network of so many interconnected food chain in which one organism is eaten by two or more than other kind of organisms. So this food web is more stable because here top consumers, carnivores and all, they are getting many options. So this food web is more stable than food chain. Suppose in food chain any one level, that is grasshopper, is not there, then who will eat grass? So all the food chain will collapse. Now in food web, that is why we say that food web is more stable than food chain. So in the food web, top consumers or carnivores, they have got many options. Like for example, here you can see the clear cut difference between food chain and food web. This is food chain. Here food chain in the nature, the trees, these leaves are eaten by deer eaten by tiger. Now here food chain in grassland, grass eaten by grasshopper by frog eaten by snake, and snake eaten by eagle. Another, that is pond food chain. In pond food chain, the plants which are present in the water, they are called phytoplanktons. These phytoplanktons are eaten by zooplanktons, for example molluscans. These zooplanktons are eaten by fishes, and fishes, they are eaten by fish eater birds. So this is a linear network of food chain. Now in food web, what you are seeing, that these grass eaten by mouse can be eaten by snake, frog can also be eaten by snake, and birds can also be eaten by snake, and these all can be eaten by eagle. So many options these top carnivores are getting. So many options they are getting. So they can eat this also, they can eat this also. So this food web is more stable than food chain. So that is the difference. So a linear network, what is that? Food chain. And interconnected, all food chains are present in the nature, that is food web. Food web is more stable than food chain. So you might understood the difference between food chain and food web. Yes, next my topic is trophic levels. We studied food chain. Now what are these trophic levels? The transfer of food or energy in various steps or various levels in the food chain form trophic levels. For example, transfer of energy taking place from grass to grasshopper, grasshopper to frog, frog to snake, snake to eagle. Now this each step or each level where the energy transfer is taking place, that each step or each level is called trophic level. Each step, each level is called trophic level. So once again, the transfer of food or energy in the various steps in the food chain forms trophic levels. Now very important rule that is given in this chapter, that is 10% law of energy transfer. Now what is this 10% rule? This 10% rule was given by Raymond Lindemann. He says that whenever energy is transferring from one trophic level to another trophic level, only 10% is transferred. Only 10% of energy is transferred in each trophic level. In this you can see that these producers, they are trapping sunlight. Only 1% of solar energy is utilized and they prepare their food, these producers. Now these producers, when they are eaten by primary consumers, only 10% of energy is transferred. Now when primary consumers are eaten by secondary consumers, only 10% of energy is transferred. So you can understand in this way, if producers, they have 10,000 kilojoules of energy. If producers are eaten by primary consumers, then only 1,000 kilojoule energy will be there. Only 10%. Now you might be asking that where this 90% of energy is gone. So this 90% of energy is gone in various life processes, in various activities, in various human activities, or various life processes means that excretion, growth and development, respiration, breathing, in all these processes the 90% of energy is lost in the form of heat. Okay, now these producers, for example, these carrot plant, this is eaten by Mr. Rabbit. Now 10,000 kilojoules of energy is there with the producers. Now, when the energy transfer will take place, the Mr. Rabbit will get only 1,000 kilojoule. Now, Mr. Rabbit is eaten by secondary consumer. Now, 1,000 kilojoule will become 100 kilojoule. Only 10% of energy will be transferred in the successive trophic levels. When one organism is eaten by another organism, that is 10% law of energy transfer. So here, now you might be thinking 90% of energy, how it is lost? The rabbit will jump and hop and all activities are there, breathing, respiration, growth and development, reproduction, other 90% is utilized in that. So the remaining 10% is only transferred to another trophic level. So that is 10% law of energy transfer, where energy flow is only 10%. Now, next to my topic is biological magnification. Biological magnification. To understand this biological magnification, it is a threat for the environment or for human beings also, or for top carnivores and top consumers. What is this biological magnification? When grass is eaten by grasshopper, grasshopper is eaten by frog, frog is eaten by snake, snake is eaten by eagle. In this food chain, I will explain that the chemicals which we are spraying, pesticides, DDT and all, they are non-biodegradable. These non-biodegradable waste all enter into the, through the food chain, enter into the next organism, and the concentration, the progressive concentration in successive levels, it will increase, and in this most affected will be human beings and top carnivores, top consumers, where these DDT or pesticides or toxic chemicals will remain there because they are non-biodegradable. So so what is biological magnification? Progressive increase in the concentration of toxic chemical substances at each successive trophic level, for example DDT, pesticides and all, this concentration will increase when you will go towards the tertiary consumers or top consumers. So that is biological magnification. My next topic is ozone depletion. This is again another threat for our environment. So ozone depletion. First of all, I will explain what is ozone. Ozone is a molecule formed by the three atoms of oxygen. When three atoms combine, ozone is formed. And our problem is ozone depletion. That means ozone is depleting. Ozone layer, which is present in stratosphere, is becoming thinner and thinner. That is ozone depletion. Now we will study all the reasons and causes why ozone layer is depleting. Because this ozone layer, which is present in the stratosphere, is very important. It protects us from ultraviolet rays. It protects us from ultraviolet rays, because you know ultraviolet rays are very harmful. Ultraviolet rays causes so many diseases, skin cancer, cataract, decreases crop yield, disturbs the rainfall pattern and all, global rainfall. So these all are the effects of, harmful effects of ultraviolet rays. So ozone layer protects us, shields us from ultraviolet rays. Now this ozone, what is this ozone? Ozone or symbol O3. Three oxygen atoms are present in the ozone. So ozone is present in stratosphere, which is 20 to 25 kilometers above the surface of Earth. Now, formation, how the formation of ozone takes place in the stratosphere? Very simple way, that high energy ultraviolet radiations, high energy ultraviolet radiations split the molecular oxygen into free reactive oxygen atoms. Here you can see in the chart the reaction. Free molecular oxygen O2, which is diatomic state, oxygen is present in diatomic state. This oxygen is split up into free oxygen atoms, nascent oxygen atoms, because these ultraviolet rays are high energy radiations. It splits up molecular oxygen into free oxygen atoms. These free oxygen atoms are very reactive. That is why they are called reactive oxygen atoms as well as nascent oxygen atoms. Reactive oxygen atoms as well as nascent oxygen atoms. They are very reactive and they at once will combine with molecular oxygen. Molecular oxygen, this reactive oxygen atom at once will combine with molecular oxygen to form ozone. So this way ozone is formed in the stratosphere layer, which is very important because this ozone layer protects us from the UV rays which are coming from the sun. Now a very important global problem is what? This in Antarctica or polar region of our world, the ozone holes are formed. Ozone holes are formed because ozone layer has become thinner and thinner, and big holes are formed in the stratosphere layer. So now it is very easy to for the penetration of ultraviolet rays on the surface of Earth. Now all nations they are thinking that why this ozone hole is formed. So the reason, the cause behind the ozone hole, depletion of ozone layer or ozone hole formation is mainly CFCs. What is this CFCs? CFCs, chlorofluorocarbon. It is a compound made up of chlorine, fluorine and carbon. This chlorine, fluorine and carbon, they are emitted from the deodorants, aerosol spray, AC, air conditioners, fridge, what we are using, the fridge and all, there from when we are using these all things, these CFCs, they eliminate CFCs. These CFCs are going up in the atmosphere, in the stratosphere layer, and these CFCs are releasing chlorine atoms. This CFC, again what I said, chlorofluorocarbons, they release chlorine atoms. These chlorine, what they do, again convert the ozone into oxygen. Again convert ozone into oxygen. Therefore, here big holes are formed in the stratosphere layer. That is called ozone hole. Now through this, ultraviolet rays are entering, and ultraviolet rays are, as I discussed earlier, that they are very harmful for our survival because they cause skin cancer, cataract, damaging eye, decreases the crop yield, affects the immunity of the person, disturbs global rainfall also. So very harmful rays penetration we must stop. These ultraviolet radiation, how we can stop the penetration of ultraviolet rays and all, it is very important question. We must restrict the use of CFCs. We must adopt any alternative source for running this fridge, refrigerators and air conditioners, and we must adopt 3 R's: reuse, recycle, refuse, reduce. These 3 R's we have to adapt to restrict the use of CFCs. In this way, when we will stop the use of CFCs, then ozone layer will thickens. Ozone hole will not be formed near polar regions and all. So this way we can save our environment from ultraviolet radiations. So my last topic today of our environment lesson is waste disposal method. The very important problem, that is waste disposal methods. Waste disposal methods, in this we will discuss that how to dispose all the waste in scientific way. Now various methods of waste disposable techniques are: first one, recycling; second, composting; third, incineration; fourth, sewage treatment; and fifth, biogas production. Now what is recycling? Now mainly the waste which is non-biodegradable. These non-biodegradable waste materials, they are recycled to form new products. Again and again we can use. For example, tin, can, polythene, plastics and glass, these all we can use again by processing these non-biodegradable waste. So recycled one, new products we will get. Second is composting. This composting is mainly done for biodegradable waste. Compost itself means manure. Now biodegradable waste can be buried in a big pit and can be converted into compost. This you can do at home also, composting techniques. Whatever vegetable peels, fruit peels, whatever is coming, leftover food items and all, that you have to put into a very big pit and then cover it with the soil. Then after few months it will convert into compost or manure that we can use to grow plants. Now next technique is incineration. Now from hospitals and all, so many hospital waste are there, syringes and bottles, these all waste, these mainly hospital waste is disposed by incineration technique. In this technique, these hospital waste, these all are burnt at very high temperature and converted into ash. Now next is sewage treatment. You know, sewage or excreta, these all are sent to, carried to STPs, sewage treatment plants, where sewage is filtered into organic waste and water. That means in the sewage treatment plant, this sewage and all, they are separated into organic waste and water. Water again you can reuse, and organic waste will become manure. So that is done in sewage treatment plant. And now last is biogas production. This biogas plant and biogas production very important. And in this way, whatever domestic waste and sewage, all you have to dump in the biogas plant. It has got one digester tank. There when you will dump all these sewage, animal excreta and all, when you will dump and when you will close it, the anaerobic, that means in absence of oxygen, decomposition will take place. And again we will get two things, biogas and left out residue of this excreta and all, again you can use as manure. And we can supply this biogas to villages and all, and it can be used as domestic fuel. So that is biogas production by sewage. So in this way, we can manage all the waste. Recycling, composting, incineration, sewage treatment, biogas production. In this way, we can clean our environment. So be eco-friendly. Thank you.